Hey guys, Spudknocker here, as always. And today I am super excited that we finally have our hands on the F-14A Tomcat, the latest variant of the F-14 to be added to Heatblur's F-14 Tomcat module for DCS World. Now we can definitely tell that this aircraft in front of us is an F-14A based off of the VF-154 paint scheme that is on the jet, as well as of course the very distinctive TF-30 afterburner tailpipe that we can see at the aft portion of the jet here, as well as we can tell this is a late model F-14 circa roughly around 1996 because we have a lightning targeting pod mounted on the right glove station. Now, if you guys know your F-14 Tomcat history, you guys know that VF-154 has kind of a very cool little story to it at the end of its career before it was disestablished. Leading up to the 2003 invasion of Iraq, F-14 Tomcats were actually assigned ashore to F-15E Strike Eagle squadrons. It was found that Rios, looking through the lantern pod on their large CIDs in the back seat, could find and pick out and identify targets much, much easier than Wizzos in the back seats of F-15Es looking at small MFD screens. So kind of a cool little side note here to the VF-154 skin, and it will definitely be an awesome addition and awesome counterpart to the F-15E Strike Eagle when that comes in the future. I am definitely looking forward to making some missions with F-14As and F-15Es working together. Also, you guys will note that when you first open up DCS World Open Beta after updating this morning, you will find that your F-14 keybinds are now gone. And so there's a very easy fix for this. You can either go to the settings and open up your F-14 keybind section and then load your old config files, or even easier, you can go to your saved games folder, to dcs.openbetagames folder, then go into the config, then input, find your F-14B-pilot and F-14B-Rio folders inside there, rename them F-14-pilot, F-14-Rio, and then go inside and actually rename the config files themselves to F-14 rather than F-14B. As more variants of the F-14 will be added over the coming months, the F-14 and all of its variants will be using one unified config file for the keybinds. And so renaming your F-14B config files to F-14 will make them work across all of the F-14 variants that will be in DCS World. So without further ado, let's go ahead and hop in the cockpit and get started. We can see our AI wingman there has already gone through a lot of his startup procedure. One thing with this late variant of the F-14A is the startup procedure is very, very similar, if not almost identical to that of the F-14B Tomcat. You guys will see that if you can start up the F-14B, the A is no problem. So let's go ahead and get some ground power going. And we'll get the Huffer connected. We'll get our ejection seat arm, and we'll tell Jester we're ready to go. And we've got him loud and clear. Canopy should be coming down any second.
Closing canopy. Check.
All right, we'll go ahead and turn the mirrors on since we're in single player here. Even though we're on the supercarrier in single player, the mirrors won't really kill your FPS too much, but in multiplayer, whew, you better watch out. So we'll go ahead and crank our right hand engine first, all the same stuff we would do in the F-14B, so not much different at all, if anything really. So we're looking at our RPM start to climb, looking for 20% of RPM. And we'll go ahead and bring our right throttle into the idle detent by giving the top of the throttle a good click. And we're going to see the TIT start to climb as the igniters start to ignite jet fuel in our engines and start to spin everything up. It gets real hot, and then the TIT will settle back down as the RPM settles as well. Roughly about 60% of RPM. Let's see our hydraulic pressure start to rise. Everything is going well. You guys can also see the cockpit looks incredibly, incredibly similar. It's very, very easy for pilots back in the era of the F-14 to swap back and forth between the TF-30 powered versions of the F-14 and the F-110 powered versions with very minimal avionics changes, as you guys can see here. So we'll go ahead and crank the left engine now. And while we're waiting for that to spin up, we'll go ahead and turn on our radio and be good there. We'll turn up our radio, our ALR-67, and our Sidewinder tones a little bit. And we'll go ahead and turn on our console and instrumentation lights just to help give us a little bit more contrast. A nice click on the top of the left-hand throttle. And of course, we'll start to turn on our displays. We want to keep it on the takeoff mode. And we'll keep it here for that, for the INS mode for navigation, for our INS waypoints that Jester will put in. We'll turn on our external lights, so that way they'll be ready to turn on with a press of a button when we get to the catapult. Just a quick little test to make sure that my keybind was in the right spot. And we should be good there. We're of course gonna leave our manual wing oversweep handle to the aft portion until we get to the catapult. We'll turn on our SAS switches. We'll ensure that our bypass is set to carrier, which it currently is, so we're good there. We'll go ahead and uncage our standby ADI, and we'll get it aligned with the horizon. That looks good. We'll go ahead and get rid of the standby flag on our altimeter. We're just going with standard pressure for this mission, so 299 or 2 is going to work fine for us today. And we'll go ahead and uncage our radio altimeter. And I'll give it a push just to test it out. Good to go there. VSI is looking good. Altimeter is looking good. We're at almost 100 feet off the ground. That's about the height of a carrier over the water, so that's good there. Airspeed is zeroed out, so we're good there. Let's see here. Anything else we need to worry about? It sounds like Jester is plugging in our waypoints in the back seat, so that is good to go. Keep in mind here, guys, that the Lantern Pilot Control mod does work in the F-14A, and that's what we're going to be using today to drop our GPU-16s. We've got the same loadout as our wingmen over here. We've got a Lantern Pod, a couple Sidewinders, a couple AIM-7MHs that are in the tunnel, one in the tunnel in the back, and then, of course, one on the left glove station. Two Sidewinders, two GPU-16s. Our mission for today is we've got a couple Iranian silkworm batteries that are potentially blocking the mouth of the Strait of Hormuz for civilian shipping to be moving through the Strait of Hormuz and out into the Gulf of Oman and then the Indian Ocean beyond that. So we're going to go out and actually silence the radar of that silkworm site and with our GPU-16s, and if the Iranian Air Force decides to come out and play, we'll go ahead and have a response for them as well. We do have some intel that the IRIAF F-5E squadrons at Kish Island are on alert, as well as Bandar Abbas, so our likely opponent today is going to be a couple F-5s. All right, looking at our caution and advisories panel, we've just got wing sweep and KDEC, so that's what we want to be seeing. We're pretty much just waiting for Jester in the back seat at this point. And we're gonna go ahead and turn our nose wheel steering to on, our gun rate to high, and just have that set up and ready to go for us. And we'll go ahead and switch our radio over to 305, our AWACS radio channel, so that way we can get updates for any aircraft that might be around us. We should be getting pretty close here. There it is. Right about the time where I get paranoid that the INS is not working or Jester's not doing something right, it goes ahead and starts to work. So just have a little bit of patience there. And as you guys can see, you know, we're pretty much done with the startup, and that is almost exactly or more or less identical to the startup procedure in the F-14B. So this is my first like full mission, I guess you could say, quote unquote, in the F-14A. I did do a couple little air start scenarios just to make sure that my keybinds were good to go, but this is my first time actually doing a takeoff, a fly to target, drop some bombs, maybe a dogfight, come back and land on the carrier. And it'll be my first carrier landing too, so hopefully it's not too ugly. All right, so looks like he's got his radio altimeter in the back seat also good to go. So we'll go ahead and start our taxi out. We'll go for Cat 1. Oh, there, AI. AI always freaks me out on the supercarrier because I always worry that my AI wingmen are going to hit me. And we'll do our best to get a good lineup on the Catapult 1 over here. It's not exactly easy to do that from the position that we were in, but we'll try our best. And we're going to see the directors over here. Wants us over to the left a little bit more. A little bit of power. Start to bring it left a bit. And we'll stop it here. Not the best lineup, but that's okay. It'll work for today's video. And we can see our green shirts and yellow shirts are starting to do their thing. The troubleshooters are going back to do their thing. All right, we'll go ahead and kneel. Whoops, kneel. And we can see 2 is over there on Cat 2. And it magically lined us up a little bit better. And we'll go ahead and taxi forward. Get up to the shuttle. Give it a little bit more power to get up and over the shuttle. All right, we are there. Currently in tension. And we'll go ahead and unsweep our wings. Reset the K-deck. A little bit weird. Let's go ahead and reset it one more time. All right. So we'll go ahead and bring our throttle up into the afterburner position, out into zone 5, and we'll do a control wipe. Make sure that everything's good to go. Of course, we need to get our flaps in, so that's my bad. And we'll wait for our wingman to go, and we'll go ahead and salute. Gear up,
120,
flaps up,
miles. Angels 25.
And we can see our wingman over there. We'll go ahead and turn on our gray custom dot labels. We'll go ahead and get our ICS turned on. And of course, as usual, I forgot to turn on my oxygen. So we'll just make sure that we get those. And we can hear the nice growl of our wingman's TF-30 engines out in front of us. And we broke the altitude we're supposed to stay under as we transit around the boat. But that's okay. And we'll go over to cruise mode so that way we can keep that heading up on the HUD, the heading tape on the HUD. That's always helpful for navigation purposes.
We've got nails 9 o'clock and nails 6 o'clock. Wilco, switching to steer point 1.
Next thing we'll do here is we'll go ahead and turn on our pod. It's always very important. Cool, we've got power to the pod, so we're good there. We'll turn it back to the TCS camera. All right.
Friendly, E2, 1 o'clock high, 9 miles.
And we'll go ahead and start to climb out towards waypoint 2.
Okay, switching to steer point 2.
And why don't we go ahead and call up our E2 and ask for a picture.
Overlord 1-1, in field 1-1, request picture. In field 1-1, Overlord 1-1, clean. Nails, front
spike,
close
spot. Oh, we got nails right on our 6. And nails, 8 o'clock. And dirt, 1 o'clock.
All right, wing sweep seems to function just the same as it does in the F-14B. No big surprise there. Like I said, avionics are more or less identical. Just kind of playing with things. I did get a new throttle that is a very super secret from a very awesome company that I think will be really great when it comes to actually dogfighting with the TF-30 engines in the F-14A. And that is a really good way. The new throttle has a very good afterburner detent to it and will allow me to bump the throttles up into afterburner, up, you know, through the different zones of the afterburner, and then back down into full mill without accidentally pulling it back out of full mill too easily. And that will allow us to make sure we get the maximum out of those TF-30 engines, because in the F-14A, in a dogfight, from everything I've read and talking to former F-14 Tomcat pilots and Rios, it's really important to make sure that when you're in a dogfight, you keep the jet, the TF-30s in full mill power, and then just push it in the afterburner when you need more thrust. We need less thrust, bring it back down to full mill, rather than making full sweeps of the throttle across the throttle quadrant like you would with the F-14B without thinking twice about it. That's how you want to try to avoid those compressor stalls and things like that. And in talking about the TF-30 engine, as you guys know who are fans of the F-14, Robert McNamara, the Secretary of Defense back in the 60s, had a real thing for making sure the services had equipment that was used by all services. And it makes sense when it comes to certain things like, say, the different kinds of boots that different services use. They should all use the same boots. That makes sense to me. Or he really had his kind of his fantasy when it came to the F-4 Phantom, all the services using the F-4 Phantom. And he wanted the same thing to happen when it came to the F-111. Now, the Navy was slated to receive the F-111B, and in carrier trials, of course, it was seen the F-111B, there was no way it was going to be a naval fighter. It really just did not have the chops to be a naval fighter, and was really only good for being kind of a missile-carrying interceptor, just being a missile truck, similar to like the Soviet interceptors like the Flashlight and other aircraft of that nature. So we'll come around towards Siribu Nair Island over here.
And nails, 6 o'clock. And, oh, dirt, 1 o'clock. And, oh, dirt, 12 o'clock.
So I like to call Siribu Nair Island over here the Tadpole Island. It's very round with like a little tadpole tail hanging off its eastern side. It's very, very easy to recognize. And so, because of this whole impetus back then of trying to have commonality between the services, you know, it really just wasn't a good idea to, it ended up just not being a good idea at all to use the F-111B. It, like I said, it's very similar to just the missile-carrying interceptors of the Soviet Union at the time, like the Flashlight series of interceptors the Soviets were fielding. And, but the idea of going back, of keeping, you know, different things common between the services, Grumman was forced to use the TF-30 engine that was with the F-111 through its entire service life up until the 2010, when the last F-111s were retired from the Royal Australian Air Force. The TF-30 soldiered on the entire time with that aircraft. And it really wasn't a big deal because the F-111's mission set doesn't require tons of harsh back and forth movements on the throttle. F-111s aren't meant to dogfight. They're meant to go fast down low or fast up high, penetrating into enemy airspace to drop bombs, not to dogfight against MiGs. And so you don't have that violent throttle action, as well as you don't have that violent throttle action trying to land a F-111 or an aardvark on a airbase with a nice long 10,000 foot runway that's 200 feet wide, you know? Whereas you have lots of small throttle movements that are required out of the TF-30 behind the boat just to bring the aircraft back on the carrier. So, like I said, F-111B, total abysmal failure, but the not suitable engines were brought over to the F-14, and you guys will notice that in your missions in DCS World, the initial point...
Wilco, switching to initial point.
You'll notice that in your missions with the F-14A, you'll notice that your range, that awesome, fantastic range that you're used to and love with the F-14B, is reduced by roughly about 30%. Some figures I see, sometimes 25 to 30%, and it also depends on altitude. At low altitude, your TF-30s are really going to be fuel hogs, but at high altitude, they're going to be much less so. So keep that in mind as well. Also keep in mind that the F-14A with the initial lantern pod was not allowed to go beyond 24,000 feet Once you get up to that really high altitude, the original implementation of the lantern pod in the F-14 tended to quote-unquote arc and spark. So having a fire develop in your pod in a, you know, a store that's non-jettisonable is not a good idea. So you want to have to balance that kind of situation where you don't want to be above 24,000 feet, but you want to be right up against that ceiling to get the maximum fuel efficiency out of your TF-30s. And as I'm flying here, I'm already noticing that in some cases, or some, it kind of feels like I'm not getting as fast of an airspeed out of full military power that I normally would see with the F-110 engine in the F-14 Bravo. So we do have what looks like a flat face along with an SA-2 sitting out on this island over here to our left. Now our target island is Abu Musa Island, which is a smaller island that should be out here in front of us. And the pod is starting to come up, so we're good there. We'll go ahead and zoom out. And just to give you guys kind of an overview of what we're doing here, we've got that SAM site on this island over here, and we've also got our target on this island over here. And then we'll see if we get any interceptors that come out to challenge us. One kind of tip when the mission editor, when you're making your own single player missions, guys, is... Oh. 065. All right, looks like the Islamic Republic of Iran Air Force is coming out. And we got F-5 spikes out here. And we can see them on radar. Jester's got them on radar. So we'll go ahead and take care of these guys before we circle back around to actually drop our bombs. We want to try to avoid the SA-2 on this island while going for our target island, Sirabu, over here. So we'll go ahead and just continue on at a heading... 065. All right, so we're already fenced in, so let's go ahead and go to air-to-air mode. 77 miles. And I do not know why the gun is showing zero on the ammo counter. That's a little bit weird. In the mission editor, the gun is fully armed. So let's actually see if the gun is... Well, there is ammo in there, so at least we know that. Not sure if there's something that we need to reset in the cockpit here that might be new or something of that nature, but anyway, we'll make it work. All right, so it looks like we got a two ship out here, and they're heading directly for us. That's no big surprise, and they're F-5s, so hopefully that won't be too difficult. And if you guys want to know kind of a little mission editor tip for your wingmen, in your missions, set in the waypoint actions to set jettison to off or restrict jettison on, so that way you don't have your wingman dropping all of his air to ground ordnance as soon as he sees an enemy fighter coming after him or a SAM launch after him. That's something that can be a little bit annoying when you're trying to get your wingmen to attack targets and all they do is just simply drop their air to ground ordnance as soon as they feel threatened by anything around them. So at this point, I'm kind of wishing I did have some Phoenixes, but we'll make it work with Sparrows. Of course, we got two Sidewinders as well as the Sparrows. We'll see if we can actually get a kill with these Sparrows, but we'll figure that out. So we'll see that these guys are an altitude of about 20,000. So I'm going to go ahead and reduce my altitude slightly. So that way I can get a picture of looking up at them with my Sparrows rather than firing down on them. A Sparrow has a hard time dealing with ground clutter. So we'll tell our flight engage bandits. And we can see a lot of times if you had given that order without turning the restrict jettison on, he would have just popped off his external tanks and his air-to-ground ordnance right there. We don't want him to do that. We want him to engage these guys, take them out, and then turn around and start to head back to drop his bombs on our target. And we've got a good pod, so we'll go ahead and bring our back over to the TCS. Oh, there he goes, out in front of us.
All right. I'm spiking him. Target, 34 miles.
Yep, I was about to say, about 30 miles out. Looks like he's going for the guy on the left, so I'll go for the guy on the right. That sounds like a good division. And you can see, as I move the throttle in and out of afterburner, you can hear the different pops as we go through the different stages of the afterburner. So stage 1, 2, 3, 4, and 4, and 5. Pretty darn cool.
Target, 25 miles.
So we're going real fast here. We gotta be careful that we don't yank on the stick too hard. Otherwise, we really don't want to rip our wings off. That would be a bad way to continue this video. I wonder if the AI is still working on the F-110 system. Oh, look at that loft from that MH. Nice. That's cool. Because my wingmen seem to be a lot faster than me. All right, we're starting to get into visual range here.
14 miles.
And we'll put him on the defensive by firing a Sparrow at him. So there's a Fox 1. And looks like my Sparrow did not loft.
Switching to PSTT.
And that probably just trashed the Sparrow there. Oh, nope, it's tracking still. He's going up. I'm gonna go up with him. All right, there's another Fox 1. And
target.
Fox 1 again. All right, I'm not sure what just happened to that second Sparrow that I fired. Oh, yep, it went stupid. There it goes off the left-hand side. We're keeping this Bandit defensive, though, which is definitely what we want.
It's game time.
And come on, splash. Nice. All right, we're going to look for that second Bandit around here somewhere.
4 o'clock low. The Bandit is down.
We're going to turn into where we thought our wingman was before. All right, there's two aircraft down here. We're going to come around. Notice I just moved the throttle from afterburner to full mill and back into afterburner. I'm not going to be moving the throttle.
You spiked a buddy.
All right, that's our friendlies. Thanks, Jester, for that. Okay, so it looks like two's on his... Nice job, two.
The Bandit is going down.
All right. So we just splashed two Iranian F-5s. I don't know. I didn't see their paint job. Maybe they're black MiG-28s. Who knows? And there he goes. A literal splash. He ended up splashing into the waves. Awesome. All right. So we'll go ahead and get rid of that annoying sidewinder sound. We'll go ahead and flow back to air to ground, and we'll figure out where the heck we need to go here. So we'll go ahead and have Jester take us to our surface target.
Switching to surface target.
I don't believe that that's our target island there. Let's see, where are we going? Yep, that is our target island. So we're going to come back around this way. Air to ground ordnance, select ordnance, GBU-16s. Probably because he hasn't seen them yet. Anyway, let's see if our mission editor work actually helped. Yep, he's still got his GBU-16s, and he's still got his external tank. So it actually worked. So that's pretty cool. Go back to our pod. All right, we'll go pod to air to ground mode, and we'll queue up waypoint 1. Sorry, we'll cue our ST. There we go. We'll zoom in our field of view. And we'll go... Let's see what we can find here. So that is in fact the wrong island. We gotta steer around to this island over here. Got a little bit confused on our navigation there. Let's see. There we go. That was my problem. Okay, so we'll actually come around to the south. This will be better anyway, so that way we can do a run into the target without having to worry about running into the threat ring of the SA-2 that's over on the other island off to the west. And there's the SA-2 on cue. Alright, so we're now masked, so we'll come around down to the south here. And at this point now, we're kind of more straight and level. We're not worried about hard maneuvering unless that SA-2 over here off to our right-hand side fires at us. We can manipulate the throttle a little bit easier without having to worry about potentially causing a compressor stall. So we're kind of boxed in a weird position here with the pod being on our right-hand side. Let's see if we can maneuver the pod to unmask it a little bit easier. Let's see, we're in, just checked it 90 degrees left. Let's see if it unmasked or not. Probably not. Yeah, so we can go a gentle turn here. We'll throw on the autopilot, and we'll go to... we'll start looking for that. There we go. That looks like the radar right there. We'll go ahead and arm the laser. And we'll designate that point. And now we're going to have to check our laser code and put the laser. All right, so we've got 1576 for our laser code. All right. So we'll go ahead and look at our pod here. And so we'll then use the S4 hat, 1576 for our laser. So we should be good there. We now should be emitting the correct laser code. And we'll go ahead and make a 270 degree turn to the right hand side. So that way we're making our run into the target from the south-ish, from the southeast. So that way we don't run into the threat ring from that SA-2. And we'll engage the radar for the silkworm battery, and then we'll head on back to the carrier. And if our wingman decides not to engage, well, that just saves the taxpayers a couple thousand dollars. All right, we're coming into our target here. What is up with our pod? There we go. All right, we'll zoom this in. And based on what we can see here, this definitely looks like the radar van. So we'll go ahead and move this in here. Maybe the radar van's off to the right slightly. And we'll go ahead and come right again. There we go, lining up our shot. coming to the left. And we're currently lasing. Time to impact. Alright, we got 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and splash.
9 o'clock.
Nice shot. Alright, we did have a little bit of difficulty with the pod there, getting it to into area track mode and then point track mode to get it onto that target. And the reason for that was I neglected to put the pod into air-to-ground mode. We were still in air-to-air mode, and it's, you know, obviously the pilot control mod for the Lantern pod is not ideal because we can't actually see the control column for the Lantern pod in the back seat. And so we couldn't see some of the actual lights that were on the panel. And so I, being an idiot and not looking at the mode for the pod, kind of got a little bit confused as to what mode the pod was actually in. But anyway, we got it sorted out, and so we'll reattack here. I believe that may have not been the radar. I believe the radar is actually over here. But the good thing is we have a second GBU-16 to reattack with. Obviously, it is a little bit difficult to pick out actual types of targets with the Lantern pod. And it is interesting to me that F-14s with Lantern pods were attached to those F-15 squadrons, like we said earlier, and were supposedly able to identify and find targets a lot easier. Maybe that's because the F-15E at that time was using a pod that was of a similar kind of fidelity when it came to its imaging capabilities, and so that was the reason why, but it's definitely interesting. I'd have to go back and look up the actual dates as to when the Lightning pod came online for jets like the F-15E. All right, so we'll go ahead and throw autopilot back on. We're back in area track mode, and we'll go after this next target here. Cue designate mode, and we'll come down to the south a little bit more so that way we can avoid the smoke and allow our laser to hit the target accurately. That looks like a larger vehicle, so that definitely is probably the actual radar van. Looks like maybe we hit a support vehicle earlier, so we'll go ahead and come back in. Weapon away, laser firing. Hopefully we can get this impact and get out of the way of that SA-2 before we get too far inside of its threat wing. So based on our new look as to what this vehicle is, I believe we actually did hit that radar van. This looks like a Zill truck with a ZSU-23 on the back. I thought this ZSU-23 on the back was actually a radar array. And here comes the bomb. And splash. Good shack. Alright, and there on cue is the SA-2, so we'll go ahead and turn cold away from the SA-2 site. And I think we just notched their radar there. Alright, and now let's go ahead and head back to the boat and try our attempt at a first carrier landing with a TF-30 powered F-14 Tomcat. Yeah, so two good shacks right there. Take out some AAA, take out a radar van, good to go. I guess our wingman is not going to engage those targets, so we'll go ahead and bring our wings back to automatic mode, out of auto mode. Now that we've gotten rid of some of the weight of our jet, both fuel weight as well as bomb weight, I think that our TF-30s are doing a better job keeping us at a higher airspeed without going into afterburner. And based off of our what we can see in the pod here, I think our BDA is probably a good mission accomplished there. So, awesome. Yep. Cool. All right, so we'll go ahead and go back to our TCS camera. We'll go back to our VDI. And we'll use our TACAN to help us steer back towards the George Washington. Alright, well I guess that's not happening, so we'll go ahead and have him steer us back towards waypoint, our home base.
Switching to home base.
Alright. So I know there has been a bug lately when it comes to the carrier's TACAN sometimes turning off after it's been on for a while, so we'll go ahead and have our flight rejoin. We'll just give ourselves a little bit of a bearing. So it's going to be like 245, 470. And directly over the top of Sirabu Nair Island, the Tadpole Island. So that's going to be perfect for us. And there's our wingman joining back up with us. And we'll climb up to about 20,000, so we'll level off 20,000. So got our VSI pushing us up a little bit. We'll go ahead and bring the nose down a bit. All right, and we'll just make sure our tail is clear. Perfect. So in the interest of time, I will go ahead and cut out our flight coming back to the carrier to save you guys a little bit of time. And then I'll see you guys once we get close to the carrier. So see you in a little bit. Alrighty guys, so I know that I would said we would rejoin as soon as I got closer to the carrier, but I did find the issue with the TACAN that has been kind of plaguing me in the F-14 these last couple patches. When it comes to TACAN, was I actually decided to cycle the TACAN command button here between the pilot and NFO for Naval Flight Officer, or RIO, in the back seat. And that ended up making Jester able to actually tune into the George Washington. Alrighty guys, we're now just under 27 nautical miles in slant range to our carrier. So we'll go ahead and call them up on the radio and let them know we're inbound for a landing.
Marshal 010, Arkham Ops 062, altitude 5, Angels 23, hold enhancement 011, low state 5.1.
Wow, our wingman used a lot more gas than us. All right, well, we'll report seeing her at 10, and got 2993, I guess. So we'll just go ahead and enter that on our altimeter setting, and we will be inbound to the carrier here. We'll go ahead and bunt the nose down a little bit. And we'll kind of angle ourselves a few degrees to the right-hand side. I really like the new external sounds with the TF-30 engine. It's definitely a lot more squealy sounding, that kind of that whistling squeal sound that you hear in a lot of media on the F-14. Alright, we'll let her know that we see her at 10.
010. See you at 10.
And we should have been descending a heck of a lot earlier.
010. Low state 4.8.
There's the carrier down there. So we'll do a teardrop entry into the Marshall stack, just that way we can reduce our altitude more and more and more. And hopefully that plane guard helo that I had set up is not going to be interfering too much. It looks like he fell behind the carrier a bit, but hopefully that's not going to be an issue. There's our wingman. And we'll come on down to ...2,000 feet, passing through 11,000. Oh, we'll see how ugly this recovery goes. Hopefully I don't, stall an engine and then end up in the drink next to the carrier. That does happen. We'll make sure we get on the ejection early. Man, that plane guard helo is going to be a problem. But that's video game things and AI things for you. It's all good. There should definitely be a, in the future, if ED is looking into it, they should definitely try to make like a command for helicopters to be the plane guard helo. That'd be pretty cool. So now we just gotta slow down our F-14 to about 250 knots. Let's see if we can get the speed brake out there as we continue our descent down to 2,000 feet, coming up on 3,000. Definitely starting to slow our descent a little bit as we come down through 350 knots. Still descending. And we'll start to level off at 2,000. Keeping an eye on our VSI there to try and get us right on altitude. We're about 100 feet high. I'd rather be a little bit high than a little bit low. All right, coming up on 200 knots. So we'll push the throttle back up, pull in the speed brakes, and get back to 250 knots. And it looks like maybe... Oh, yep, I'm lined up wrong. So we'll go ahead and come to the right slightly. Try to center up that CDI. We'll probably just do it visually here. And we'll enter the Marshall stack at position 1.
Power 010. Overhead Angels 2. Hold enhancement 011. Low state 4.5.
Yeah, gaining a little altitude in these turns. A little bit of airspeed too. We're still off to the left in terms of the CDI. We're off to the right now. We'll make it work, though. And as we get lighter and lighter, I can see that we're getting definitely more and more slippery. Kind of closer to what we usually expect from the F-14.
Heads up,
and I'll let this bank here start to descend us a little bit back down to our Marshall stack altitude of 2,000. Hovering just below 250 knots, so we'll go ahead and push the throttle up just slightly. But we'll start to reduce the bank a little bit, so that way we can get offset by about 5 nautical miles of DME distance. Coming up on 2,000, so I'll go ahead and hit the autopilot reference button to allow us to maintain that 2,000. As we, our bank angle was a bit too high to start off, so I don't think we're going to get to 5 DME as specified. And yeah, we kind of messed up that, but that's all good. We'll come through and we'll bring the wings back to 55. We'll get the hook down. Should have had the hook down in the Marshall stack. Oh well. And we'll start to push our speed back up to 350 knots. And we're coming down to 800 feet. And coming around, looking for that plane guard helo. That's going to be a problem. And we'll go to the landing mode. About 900 feet. Right at 350 knots, so that's looking good. Bring some nose down trim, so that way we don't balloon too much. And coming around. Hopefully this doesn't suck too much. Starting to nail right at 800 feet for the upwind into the brake. Yep, definitely need some more nose down trim. Not the best entry in the world. We'll fly right over the top of our escort ship.
Nails 6 o'clock.
Deck looks clear. And power idle. Speed brake out. And we'll bring in some left rudder so that way we don't can keep our nose dug in, so that way we don't gain too much altitude. Bring the wings forward to auto. Gear down, flaps coming down. Not super clean. DLC's working. And we're too high. So we'll let it sink a bit. So this is where the TF-30 engines can be very dangerous, but we'll see how it goes. Looking for that plane guard helo so I don't hit him. There he is. I think it's going to be too low for us to really need to worry too much about it. Now I'm fast. Fast and high. So we'll be ready to call the ball here. Yep, definitely high. Definitely fast. Got the speed brakes out. Yeah, I'm too far behind the ship. That's the problem here. So we'll level off. There we go. Now we're starting to recapture it. Still too fast. Way fast.
010, portable, 9.3.
That's funny. Little low. 600 feet, that's where we want to be. Oh geez, AI wingman's probably going to hit me. Alright, that distracted me a bit, so now I'm too fast again. And I'm high, so here comes the DLC a bit. I try not to have the DLC out the entire time, but I feel like that makes me too low, usually. Lined up right, coming left. Bringing in the DLC. Alright, full power. One wire, probably.
Two wire.
Oh, two wire. That's better than I thought. Come on, flaps. Aren't the flaps coming up? Anyway, we'll get out of the landing area here. Alright, flaps aren't wanting to come up. Alright, unsure why the flaps aren't coming up, so I can't get the wings to sweep back. But anyway, so that's a pretty decent first flight in the F-14A, and not a terrible landing on the first try. Definitely had to punch out that DLC at the last minute to try and get it down onto the deck. Probably if I hadn't punched out the DLC, I maybe would have gotten a 4-wire. Maybe if I was lucky, maybe a 3-wire. I don't know. But anyway, not sure why the flaps won't come up. I think it's because I accidentally put them in emergency flap extension mode earlier. So that's probably why. But anyway, that is that. First impressions, it's really not that different from the F-14B. And we'll see in a subsequent dogfight video about dogfighting the F-14A if it's really that different in a dogfight. So, awesome new addition to DCS World, guys, and if you don't have the F-14 yet, I highly, highly recommend it. It's a very, very fun module, especially in multiplayer, when you've got a real human Rio in the backseat helping you out and doing his thing. And so, I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I'll see you guys in the next one. So, fly safe and stay healthy out there, guys.